Hello. Since the early Persian Empire, windmills and turbines have been used for many applications: milling grain, sawing wood, pumping water, providing torque for machines, and of course, producing electricity. What all these different systems have in common is that they extract the energy from the wind and convert it into a mechanical torque and power. Today, we will explore how the kinetic energy of the wind is converted into torque and power through rotor aerodynamics. We will try to answer questions such as, how do we think of wind in relation to the turbine? How does a wind turbine rotor work? How do we transform the linear motion of the wind into a rotation of a turbine? What happens to the air as it blows through a wind turbine? And does the wind slow down? Does it stop? Does anything happen to it at all? How much power can be extracted from the wind by a single wind turbine? When thinking about the aerodynamics of wind turbines, you can think about scales. The wind travels through thousands of kilometers at an atmospheric scale. When you think about the weather and local wind speed, you can think of the scale of your region, a few kilometers. This local wind will then power a wind park, which can be several kilometers long, where turbines are spaced several hundreds of meters to a kilometer apart. The next scale is that of a single wind turbine. As wind turbines have progressively grown, the rotor and blade scale can be easily over 100 meters, the scale of a large passenger aircraft. A blade is defined by a span-wise distribution of aerodynamic profiles, called airfoils, which vary in thickness, shape, and performance. The blade section will be a few meters long and define the surface of the blade. The aerodynamics over the blade section are defined by the shape of the blade and by the development of viscous flow close to the surface, creating a layer that is a few millimeters across. In this boundary layer, over the coating of the surface, small perturbations appear, small vortices generated by the forces on the surface that are fractions of millimeters and which grow, defining the final aerodynamic performance of the wind energy conversion system. The transfer of energy from the atmospheric scale down to the surface of the blade follows these decreasing scales from thousands of kilometers to the micromillimeters of the surface of the blade. These submillimeter vortices coalesce into a vortex sheet of the size of a blade and are shed in the wake sheets of the size of the rotor that travel kilometers downstream until they are diffused. In a wind farm, these sheets coalesce into a large system of vortices that exchange the energy with the upper part of the atmospheric boundary layer. These massive systems of vortices can interact in clusters of wind farms, modifying the local wind climate. When we design a wind farm, a wind turbine, a blade, an airfoil, our designs and models aim to connect these scales of vortices and forces from atmospheric scale down to the microscales of the blade surface and all the way back to the atmospheric scale. An airfoil of a wind turbine blade is generated to create one special type of aerodynamic force, lift, while minimizing the other dynamic force, drag. Lift is the aerodynamic force that is perpendicular to the wind speed that the airfoil perceives. This perpendicular force is only possible if you create those microscale vortices on the surface of the airfoil that will create the wake of the wind turbine. Drag is the aerodynamic force that is aligned with the perceived wind speed. And this is the same principle that keeps either an aircraft or a bird flying. In a wind turbine, the blade section will experience two sources of wind. First, the natural wind flowing through the turbine, which we also experience. Second, an apparent wind from the flight path of the blade due to its rotation. With these two wind directions, we'll have two components of lift. The natural wind will generate a force perpendicular to the wind direction. And the direction of this force is the direction of rotation of the blade. It propels the blade, creating torque. The wind, due to the rotation of the blade, will create a force against the natural wind and is responsible for decelerating the wind. At the airfoil and rotor scale, we can see that the wind is being decelerated, losing kinetic energy and total energy. It is this energy that is converted into mechanical energy of torque and power, which is fed into the drivetrain through the blade. The blade of a wind turbine is designed to take as much energy as possible for the least cost. This includes cost of materials, production, installation, maintenance, and all kinds of derivative costs into other systems. Although there are many constraints involved in the design and optimization of a blade, we'll start by focusing on the pure aerodynamic design. We assume that there is an optimal extraction of energy related to an optimum deceleration of the flow. And the most efficient way to do this is to extract the same percentage of energy from all the wind particles in the stream tube that crosses the area of the disk drawn by the blades as they rotate. As kinetic energy is extracted from the tube, the wind speed decreases and the stream tube expands. Because we just have two or three blades, we try to approximate this, and an average deceleration and forces of the blades apply on the wind. As we look onto the blade, we can see that the outer region of the blade sweeps a large circumference. This circumference increases linearly with the radial position. Therefore, the loading along the blade has to increase linearly with the length of the blade, so that the average loading in each ring of flow crossing the turbine is uniform. But how much energy can we actually extract? Until now, we have discussed how the conversion of energy occurs at the wind rotor, focusing on the creation of torque. But how much power can we extract? Is there an optimum? Is there a maximum? With a simple calculation, we'll show that the wind turbines have an optimal operating condition beyond which they cannot generate more energy. Simply, one cannot extract all the energy from the air. The first rule to determine how much energy we can extract is to define that mass, momentum, and energy must be conserved along our stream tube. We can also think of the wind turbine as an actuator disk of area A, which uniformly decelerates the flow. As the flow loses kinetic energy, we can define that the turbine decelerates the flow by an induction factor A, and wake system decelerates the flow also. We can define conservation of mass and momentum and power as a function of this induction factor A. Therefore, we obtain a simple expression for power as a function of the deceleration of the wind. Through further simplification, one can define a thrust coefficient and a power coefficient. The thrust coefficient is the force exerted by the turbine divided by the total impulse of the flow, whereas the power coefficient is the power extracted by the turbine divided by the total power that the flow could have provided. When plotting the power coefficient as a function of the induction factor, we can see that the maximum power coefficient will occur when the flow is decelerated by 1/3 at the actuator disk. This will result on a power coefficient of about 59%. This is called the Betz limit, named after the scientist who defined it, and means that at most, a single wind turbine can only extract 59% of the power of the incoming wind. We hope that you enjoyed this introduction to the aerodynamics of wind turbines.